This is the Friday Session.
He's from Redditch. It's live music from Dan Sealey. Live music from Dan Sealey here on the Friday Session, introducing on BBC Hereford and Worcester. But we can normally find you, Dan, doing bass, Ocean Colour Scene. That's a gig and a half.
It's all right, yeah. It's better than working for a living, I suppose.
Absolutely, because this kind of opportunity came out from another band which you were doing up in Redditch, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was in a band called Late, and we did a few supports for OCS. We played in Birmingham and Nottingham, I think, in sort of 19... No, I think it was about 2001, actually. And then I got a phone call asking if I could play bass just after Damon Minchella was the old bass player, he left. So I've sort of did one gig for them at the Albert Hall, and that was what was supposed to be sort of the sort of subtotal of what I was going to be doing, and they just decided they'd stick with me, so I've been with them ever since.
What was that phone call like?
It was quite bizarre, really, because I'd never really played bass before, so I had to sort of do a little bit of blagging and sort of say that I was absolutely fantastic on the bass, having never sort of played a note on it before. But you know, it's only
straight on the internet. Then watching YouTube videos.
Well, yeah, I bought a few of the albums and sort of figured out that their old bass player was actually really, really good. So I had to learn pretty quickly. But the first gig we did was a tribute to Ronnie Lane at the Albert Hall. So that was quite a nerve-wracking start as well, because there's a lot of people like Paul Weller and Pete Townsend and Ronnie Wood all on the same bill. So getting that out of the way was sort of the first sort of hurdle, really. And once that was out of the way, it was okay, and I sort of managed to find my way around the instrument and got myself sort of fairly proficient, I think, because I've still got a job, so I can't be doing that bad.
And being a Worcestershire man, you're also an avid cricketer as well, aren't you?
Yeah, I've been playing cricket for Ulster Bank since I was about 10 years old, and I think you've bumped into us on the Village Knockout run before now. We did quite well last year. I was captain last year. But unfortunately, I missed one of the rounds because I was away. I was away with the band, so that's the problem with sort of cricket and music. So it doesn't really cross over that well.
Do any fans kind of turn up at your cricket games?
The missus sometimes comes, but that's about it.
And tell me a little bit about some of your solo work, because you've been doing a lot. Well, when you get the time of your own work, haven't you?
Yeah, well, I do a lot of writing, and I've always done that. I mean, I've written a few for Ocean Colour Scene. One that's going to be on the new album that's coming out. I've written one that we did on the last album and one that we've been playing live. So I've been doing a lot of writing. I've also got I work with another talented singer-songwriter called Paul McCormack, who's very, very talented. And we do a little open mic thing at the Odd Fellas Arms in Astral Bank every other Tuesday. We're kind of trying to build up a little sort of following there and start working on perhaps the folk scene a little bit with our just acoustic stuff. But it's sort of fitting it in between everything else I've been doing in it. But it's all good.
Open mic nights, playing village cricket. You'd think you'd have some stalkers there.
It's not very rock and roll, is it? But it's good. It's a nice place to live as well. So.
And let's talk about the rock and roll. Name some of the places you've been to with OCS.
We did the Fuji Rock Festival in Japan. We played in South Korea. We've played all over Spain. We're going to Dubai next month to do a festival over there. So. I'm not sure what that'll be like, but it'll probably be hot, I'd imagine.
What's that transition been like from playing at places like open mic nights as doing your own project to playing in front of thousands? Can you remember that?
First time we did Tea in the Park in Scotland, we've always had a really good following in Scotland, and I remember walking out on stage there, and I think it was on the telly as well, and it was sort of about my fourth or fifth gig in, I think, and I'd previously been playing at the Jug of Ale in Moseley and places like that. And we were playing to 15,000-20,000 people, something like that. And it was the atmosphere was so intense, it was just unbelievable. And my overwhelming memory of that gig was, one, I was absolutely terrified walking out, and I was just so unsure of my ability to even, get...
Play through. The bass.
Yeah. And the other was that I was desperately in need to go to the toilet from about the third song in. So it was sort of battling through that and trying to figure out how I was sort of trying to plot ways of how I could get off the side of the stage and perhaps relieve myself, but it just didn't happen. So I spent the whole time in a serious amount of pain during that gig.
That'll be the reason for the funny dancing.
Yeah, there was some funny dancing and some gurning going on as well. There's some funny faces being pulled, but yeah, it was an experience.
Where's been your best gig?
We've always done well at the V festivals. We did play the V festival this year. We played on the main stage this year. We was sort of early on, but atmosphere was absolutely fantastic. And the previously before that, we played in one of the marquees at V, and that was again really good. We play Barrowlands in Glasgow, which is just unbelievably hectic, and we've got a very loyal and passionate following up there. And that's always an amazing gig. A little bit intimidating, but it's just an amazing atmosphere, and you you're in the thick of a proper gig when you're playing there. But there's been so many good ones, that it's to pick out the best is pretty hard to do, really.
Right, where's the worst?
We played in no disrespect to people from Grimsby, we played in Cleethorpes near Grimsby not so long ago. And it wasn't so much the gig that was bad, it was sort of like on, I think it was on a Butlin's holiday camp, it was a festival that was moved to somewhere else, and it was a sort of, wasn't exactly glamorous, it had the old silver tassels on the back of the stage, and it was like playing at a social club, but it was a bit of fun, but I don't think I'd sort of rush back to play it again, to be honest.
Let's name some of the big OCS songs. There's the Riverboat Song, there's 100 Mile High City, Day We Caught the Train. Which one's the most complicated to play?
Well, we never rehearsed Day We Caught the Train because it's sort of it's just a given that we know how to play it. And I suppose, to the rest of the band, it might be easy, but that's a real tough one on the bass, that is. So I always request that we rehearse it, but we never do. So consequently, I always get it wrong the first gig of a tour because I think, it's got so many notes in it that it's quite complicated.
Riverboat is a long song as well to play, isn't
it? Yeah, but you only have to sort of just, it's just that. You can't really go wrong with that, just do that in a few different keys. You can always sort of find your way back to where you were, but if you get lost in Day We Caught the Train, you sort of have to retrace your steps, and you can get a little bit, I've got a little bit panicky before and ended up in different keys and all sorts, turn the bass down and just try and look good, I think, is it?
Anything gone wrong?
Oh, hundreds of things, yeah. You know, it's all been a very Spinal Tap over the years. And I think it'd be the same for most bands, really. But there's been many a drunken occasion when people have, you know, fallen over, forgot the words, argued amongst the crew, and, you know, it's just all rock and roll, really, isn't it?
You're going to do another track for us now, then we'll have a bit more of a natter. What's the next one?
Yeah, I'm going to do Mr. Marshall. I'm going to have to swap guitars. This is a song that that I've played with Ocean Colour Scene. We've done it live a few times. I think Paul Weller said he liked it. Or he might have said he didn't like it. Well, I wrote this song as like a bit of a... I didn't sort of ever intend it to be anything major. It was just a sort of little sort of folk song, and it was so folky to me that I just never thought I'd do anything with it. But I happened to play it to Steve, our guitar player, and he was so impressed with it that we ended up playing it a few times at our gigs. So it's worked out all right for me, this tune.
Hello, Mr. Marshall, where did your lazy son go? He's with people who he knows, where the flowers won't grow. And so, Mr. Marshall, what has he gone to do, though? Well, he took the lost souls to show them the flowers would grow. So how do you feel? He said it doesn't seem real. He's such a good boy. Wounds will heal, and the devil will guide him until he comes home. The boy that we love won't be left on his own. They sent him to show them the flowers have grown, but the empire will crush them before they've been shown. The empire will crush them before they've been shown. Hello, Mr. Marshall, where did your lazy son go? He's with people he knows, where the flowers won't grow. So, Mr. Marshall, what has he gone to do? Show them the flowers would grow. So how do you feel? He said it doesn't seem real.
live music from Dan Sealey from Redditch here on the Friday session, introducing on BBC Hereford and Worcester.
BBC introducing 100% local music from Herefordshire and Worcestershire.
More music and chat from him later.
Introducing the best Worcestershire bands.
I quite like Zebedee Rays from Worcestershire. The Gills on Film, and they're from Worcester area.
Sam Isaac's pretty
good. Sam Isaac, yeah. I love Sam Isaac, yeah.
Malvern.
The best local event for me is Nosstock Festival. It's just a really, really beautiful festival, and we got a really good reaction, and we got to play it looking up this hill, and there's all these pretty lights and everything. It was amazing.
Evesham.
The Secret Sound, they're a band in Evesham. We really like them.
Very good.
Kidderminster.
Week 13 for Kidderminster, because they just are really friendly guys.
They do experiment with their music, so they rock.
Worcester.
Best three bands from our area.
I'd say number one, The Capital.
Pershore.
I like the Spoonfest. We've seen them not so long ago.
100% local music. This is the Friday session.
Unsigned, undiscovered, and under the radar music.
Time for some more live music on tonight's programme. It's from Redditch. It's Dan Sealey. Music from Dan Sealey here on the Friday session, introducing on BBC Hereford and Worcester. If you've got a question for him tonight, 07786204104, Friday session at bbc.co.uk. But you say you're actually going to be chasing more folk with your solo project rather than the rock. Why is that?
I was brought up with in a folky background. My dad used to do folk festivals. He was in a duo called Cosmotheca, and they did sort of musicals and musical and folk songs. And they're soon to reform as well, hopefully. And I might be playing a part in that, so that's something else to sort of look out for. But my mother as well, she was a caterer at folk festival, so my sort of musical upbringing was based around sort of bearded vegetarians, you know, sort of singing with one finger in the air. So, and it must have rubbed off on me, because when I started writing songs, they all came out like acoustically, and I got into acoustic guitar more than electric guitar. And I sort of always felt the need to wear chords and grow sideboards. So I've got a sort of affiliation with folk music. My dad brought me up on the Beatles as well, and I always loved their acoustic stuff. So that's sort of the direction that it took for me.
And what you're playing, is it very similar to what you're listening to?
I listen to all sorts. I listen to a lot of sort of rock music, especially some of the mod stuff. But I do tend to sort of acoustic and harmonies tend to sort of float my boat, really.
What's the next step for you?
I've got a lot of things going on. Going to do a bit more writing with the band, do a bit more writing myself. I'm going to be doing some Cosmotheca type stuff with my dad as well. So there's a lot going on. I'm just going to try and keep my finger in as many musical pies as I possibly can, because that's the only way you can make a living out of it, I think.
You mentioned your dad quite a bit there.
Yeah.
What are your parents thinking about you now? You flying all over the world. What was it like when you had to first break that news to them? I've got a busy gig calendar.
Yeah, I think my dad always discouraged me from being a musician, because he's sort of had a very hard life trying to eke out a living from doing it himself. So he wanted me to be a cricketer, but... there was a crossover where I decided I was going to, you know, buy a guitar and grow my hair long and sort of get involved in sort of that kind of life, rather than sort of wasting my Saturday afternoons. Well, not wasting my Saturday afternoons, but spending my Saturday afternoons in whites. And I got to about an age of, about 18, I think, and then I sort of knocked cricket on the head for a bit. And it's only recently, over the last sort of few years, that I've really got back into playing sport again. But my dad was sort of... kind of over the moon because he came to a few gigs and he was very proud. We played it in Birmingham the other night, and he was sort of filling up, and my mum, you know, just sort of, she's happy as well, I think.
Is it frustrating being in Ocean Colour Scene when you're the last person to join, and all the other people are kind of earning all the royalties from the songs they wrote the first time?
Yeah, that's tough. But it, in the music business, I've found isn't easy. It's not easy to make a hell of a lot of money very quickly. But you know, the live side is where you can make a living, and we're lucky that we do go out and play a lot of live gigs, so that sort of keeps me going, and the missus.
Absolutely. And you know, just tell me a little bit about Redditch as well. What's it like trying to be in a band and carry on living in the local area?
Where I live is quite a nice sort of laid back area, and sort of just sort of blending in the local pub, really, and sort of keep myself to myself. But we have recently started, as I said, we've been doing these sort of open mic things, and it was something I never really wanted to do, but the landlord sort of badgered me into it, promising me a few ciders in return. But it's a nice area to be, actually. It's quite nice.
Tell me a little bit about some of the inspirations behind your songwriting as well. The lyrics, do they mean anything?
Lyrically, I just sort of make it up as I go along, really. Whatever pops into my head. The missus always thinks it's about her in some way, shape or form.
She's smiling in the corner there.
It isn't always. unless it's, you know, she's ugly and she's smelly.
She smiles at the love songs.
Yeah, that's right. She likes to think they're about her.
Excellent. Well, really appreciate you coming in tonight. You can do one final number for us tonight. What's the last one, and what's it about?
I'm going to have a crack at doing an Ocean Colour Scene song. It's a B-side that I've always thought was a really underrated song, and I think they should have done more with it. It's called Hello Monday.
This is the Friday session.